Join, wager, cash in, and get a $150 bonus. Sign up now at TVG.com.
Please be joined on the line right now, as promised, as advertised, Craig Milkowski, chief figure maker for Timeform US. Craig, you there?
I am, Matt. Good morning.
Good morning to you. First question for you is, for those out there that aren't that familiar with, you know, the Timeform US figures, how would they go about getting a hold of them, and how do you go about making your figures?
Well, they can get a hold of them through, obviously, through your guys' handicapping store,
right,
at TVG, and also at timeformus.com. And as far as making them, I've been making figures for quite a while and kind of refined the method over the years. But the main thing is that's different from other providers is that they incorporate the pace, not only in the overall figure, but when I make the variant. So I think it kind of gives us an edge over some of the other products out there.
All right, well, I'm going to have you and Nick talk about, we had our first, I guess, kind of derby prep race over the weekend. You guys can banter back and forth about Midnight Hawk, who won that race. Craig, you first. I mean, it was just a field of four. So what do you make a win? It was a grade three. Baffert seems to like this horse. But again, it was just three opponents he had to deal with.
Right, yeah. And really, on paper, it was pretty much a virtual match race. And then it played out that way on the track with the only two real contenders engaging right from the beginning and going around the track. And looked like the better of the two won. The pace was pretty quick, and like it's being a virtual match race, that's to be expected. So normally I wouldn't be very excited about three-year-olds that go fast early and slow down late, but I'm willing to give a little bit of an excuse given the dynamics of the race.
Nick, what did you think of that performance?
Well, personally, Craig, thanks for coming on this morning. For me, individually, I thought the performance of Midnight Hawk was on point in a sense that, you know, for a horse just making his second career start, you know, stretching out, I thought he relaxed enough. You know, again, this horse showed to me that there's definitely something here. You'll watch him, Martin Garcia going left-handed, you know, getting him to come just off the rail because he does drift in a bit once Christo shifts out. But I love the way his ears go up at the wire as if he had something in the tank there. So I think visually, he definitely looks to be a horse that's on the right track.
All right, Craig, so we're looking at figures. So prior figure 95, that debut, 99, so going the right direction, which is what you want to see. Is a 99 kind of on par for a horse of this quality this time of year, above par, below par?
Yeah, I would say it's about par for this time of year. I don't remember the exact Breeders' Cup juvenile figure, but I think it was a little bit lower. So you would expect the horses as they get, you know, improve and mature to be getting a little bit faster, so...
Okay.
I wouldn't say it was anything special, but it's probably right about where he should be to be competitive with the others.
Well, that's quite a compliment, I think, just the second start of his career. And even though he's a three-year-old, the Breeders' Cup Juvenile for two-year-olds, that race is only 2 months ago over the same racetrack. So that's pretty complimentary when it comes to Midnight Hawk. We're talking to Craig Milkowski, Timeform U.S. chief figure maker. Staying at Santa Anita, the San Pasqual, which I personally thought going in was a very, very tough race. I thought there was a fair amount of speed signed on in this race, but Blue Skies and Rainbows off of a big win at Betfair Hollywood Park does it again here in the San Pasqual. This horse has been around for a little while. Is he as good now as he's ever been?
He certainly is. He's been pretty good for a long time. It seemed like on Saturday, the pace figures I gave the race were kind of on the low side, and then he finished fast. For whatever reason, like you said, it looked like there was more speed on paper.
Mm-hmm.
But it just didn't materialize. He had a fairly easy lead, only tracked by, I think the horse was the longest shot in the field that was pressing him. And when he dropped out, he was just left alone all by himself and ran away from the others. I mean, I don't know that this was the strongest grade two we're going to see this year, but it was a solid performance.
Well, you know, Craig, it was interesting through the early stages of this race, and I had a brief discussion with Ron Ellis, the trainer of Majestic City, who's going to get touched out for third. That's Majestic City on the inside, red with Edwin Maldonado. Martin Pedroza, it's kind of reminiscent of a boxer when he walks into the ring. He employed intimidation tactics because he was aggressive through the first few yards. Maldonado looked over at him, and Pedroza obviously was the kind of the instigator of saying, I'm going to take the initiative here and go to the lead. It would have been interesting.
Sounds right for him.
Right. Exactly. But what I didn't like was the fact that you have a horse in Majestic City and Edwin Maldonado who conceded for a horse whose best suit is to be on the lead or engaged. So, Craig, in that regard, do you take into consideration that Majestic City was actually making up ground late and he's not normally that type of horse? Or how do you phrase that, or how do you look at that?
I'm not very impressed with what Majestic City did. I mean, you can blame the rider, blame the horse. I mean, maybe if you think he could have been given a smarter ride, you know, he finishes better. But on the other hand, if he engages Blue Skies and Rainbows, maybe neither one of them's there at the finish. I thought Majestic Harbor kind of closed nicely at the end. Actually looked like he was gaining ground while the winner was under some pressure. So he may be one to watch going forward if he was to get a little better set up.
All right, we talked about a couple of the two big races at Santa Anita over the weekend. It was opening weekend at Oaklawn Park. They have a big race, by the way, coming up on Monday for three-year-olds in the Smarty Jones. But, Craig, you want to talk about the fifth season, and I believe a horse named Drogue.
Yeah, Drogue ran right off the television screen watching that race. Opened up one by 9 or 10, I think mm-hmm. it was. And I believe he paid $3, but that was only because he was part of an entry with Cyber Secret. Had he been uncoupled, he surely would have paid much more than that.
Yeah. One of the many reasons why I hate entries, Craig.
Yeah, that was one of those owner entries, too. Wasn't even the same trainer. So if you like Drogue, you didn't really get the best of it in that race, that's for sure.
Craig,
he had come off a very impressive win the time before, where he had set very fast fractions and kind of drew off the win. So this was his second consecutive lifetime top, which is kind of rare for a six-year-old. He's five, I believe.
Craig, what are your thoughts as far as the surface? Is it a situation where you have a sharp horse that was coming off of a powerful score, you mentioned from a figure standpoint, that simply handled the track better than its competition? Or, I mean, obviously, as far as figures go, this horse showed a big number. Is this a horse to look for, or do you think the wet track may have induced the performance and may have actually handicapped those horses that finished behind him?
Yeah, so every year when Oaklawn opens, the track seems to be a little bit tricky. It's always, almost always, very slow and kind of have to take the performances with a grain of salt. And, I mean, he ran a good race. His time form U.S. speed figure was a 114. Which is good, but it's not going to win any grade one races for older horses. So, you know, it's kind of, I'd want to see more from him going forward. I mean, he's certainly probably going to step it up into the bigger races at Oaklawn, and we'll see where he goes from there.
Wow, you served 23 years in the U.S. Air Force.
Yeah,
wow,
sure
you're a tough dude.
Thank you for your service, by the way, Craig.
Wow.
Oh, thank you.
Okay. And you want to talk about one more, or I think, Ready for More? Is that where we're going right now, Craig?
Yeah, Ready for More, kind of just another one that just blew the field away in an allowance optional claimer down the hill at Santa Anita. And he's actually the six-year-old who also had two consecutive lifetime tops on my numbers. Bettors weren't fooled as he moved from a claimer, stepped up in class to the allowance optional claimer. He did have the tag, and he went off the favorite at 5-2. But, I mean, he was just never headed. He broke on top, opened up, and stayed that way all the way around the track. Interesting that both of his last two tops were since being claimed by Mike Pipey, who obviously had found something good with the horse, but now he lost them to Mike Mitchell. So we'll have to see what he's able to do with them.
Okay, Craig, but before we let you go, I know there's not a lot going on today in racing. I mean, we have good racing from Tampa, but not a lot going on. Is there anything that, you know, I know you make your figures in advance. I mean, Nick and I would like to have a bone thrown our direction. Is there anything tomorrow that you really like in New York or out here at Santa Anita, or is it still too early yet for you?
To be honest, I haven't had a chance to look at New York yet. I got thrown back a little with them running on Monday, so I'm still doing the figures from there. But if you follow me on Twitter, I'll be sure to put a few things on there.
Okay, all right, we'll cut you some slack.
What is your Twitter handle, by the way, Craig?
Timeform US Figs.
I'm there.
Timeform US Figs. Craig Milkowski, Timeform US Chief Figure Maker. Thank you so much for coming on, giving us some insight into what took place in some of the big races last weekend. And I think we'll be doing this fairly often on Wednesday, so look forward to doing it again in the future.
All right. right. I look forward to it. Thanks, guys.
All right,
thanks,
Craig. Now get to work, Craig. Now get to work.